read something to you from the New York Times.
Oh. Some of you may have been following this, and I just had the exact language. Anyway, in spending so much time together, talking about some things that are really troubling and negative in the world, there's some positive news happening in the world, and we thought we should just share it together, and basically deciding the Army Corps of Engineers is not going to issue permits on the pipeline.
Digital devices, if that's handy. I just need one note card. there's like say,
you'd rather type something in a note or an email to yourself. That's okay.
You got devices, you have writing utensils.
Go super obvious and come up with as many of these actions actions as possible. And it will help frame your thinking if you just kind of choose to focus on one of these two topics.
All right, you have a minute for list making in silence. Go. Share your list with somebody close beside you. And as you're sharing that list, if you hear something that's truly terrible, you're like, wow, you're sick. That is a really good thing. Add it to your list. And some of you, I know it's hard to think this way. It's opposite of how we're taught to think. So if you hear something truly terrible, just add it to your own list. Feel the worst. All right? You have 2 minutes to share with a partner each other's list. Go ahead and share. Thank you. group speaker, but I would like one person from each group to stand up and just tell me one or two things that rose to the surface in your conversation. So one person from each group stand up, please. You're like,
supporting outright campaigns and not allowing ourselves to be silenced and wasting people's time.
We're going to ask for citizenship papers for entrance to arts events. And we're going to resurrect the old, demeaning, discriminatory language of arts critique, including comments about how one looks.
Donate money to the KKK and take a lot of drugs.
And we will support all of the greedy developers in changing our neighborhood into being extremely gentrified.
Awesome. Thanks. Awesome. Here.
Add terrible
things to your terrible list. We're gonna one, two, four, I almost said three. One, two, four, all. And I'm going to change the impetus a little bit. And this is kind of the harder thing to do, what I'm about to propose. I want you to go down that list, item by item, and ask yourself, is there anything that we are currently doing in any way, shape, or form that resembles this item? And you have to be kind of brutally honest to do this. Now, some things there won't. But for example, when I say, oh, I'm going to put Steve Bannon on my community advisory board, well, that's about policing bodies of color, Muslim people. I can look at that and think, well, that's about policing. Well, I know that the security in my building is not particularly friendly to non-white, non-wealthy folks. So that's the analogy I can make from the very worst possible thing to maybe a practice that's actually happening a little bit in my environment. Frank, you have one example?
Sure. So for example, in a gentrification project or a neighborhood redevelopment project, while you want to engage a lot of folks, you may realize that you have no one on your board that looks or resembles that particular neighborhood or has a history or a connection to that neighborhood, and you may realize you haven't done anything to actually change that or to bring someone onto your board as a reflection of what you're really trying to do in a particular neighborhood, right? So you may realize, even though you were not furthering gentrification per se, there was a behavior deep down that you maybe didn't think of yet.
Right? So you just take that list for 1 minute. For 1 minute, you're going to take that list and just look at each item and see if it echoes with any practice that's alive in your building. And some of them won't. But I would imagine there are some items on that list in which there is an echo. So again, we're going to do one, two, four, all, skipping the three. So you're going to have a minute to just study that list on your own and then create a new list of kind of analogous similarities, okay? So 1 minute. Go ahead and start. Brutally honest. And in silence, you're working in silence.
This can be things in your practice, your organization's practice. It may not be you necessarily, but if you see things in your organization that are happening that resemble this behavior, that can count too. If you see collaborators or folks in your community, among your supporters, if you see that behavior, that can count too.
Necessarily. the reading culture to
from them, forgetting that they gave it to us, ignoring it, and not acknowledging that they own that information.
Thank you. talked about economic support or patronizing or partnering with gentrifying businesses that services are out of the reach of original neighbors.
I don't need that. We talked about that. Basically doing nothing, and I think that's the worst thing, just doing nothing when it comes to racial injustice and feminine injustice.
We talked about the practice of not presenting local artists, bringing in artists from out of the city, and this is that how creates a situation where you're not presenting artists of color who are present locally, and also just the aesthetics and kind of some of the traditional aesthetics around what makes high quality art and how that marginalizes, potentially marginalizes a lot of people from the conversation.
Oh, I'll take that. He can talk. He's a little
We echo the partnership with businesses and the role of gentrification of art, watching as a mechanism of gentrification. The artist's perspective, humorizing people's difference. Is one, and also not putting our bodies forward in action to be physically present or physically writing those letters, making the physical action part of our work.
What do you mean people's differences?
Humorizing.
Humor to be
what? Yeah.
Like making fun.
Long-term complacency leading to long-term complicity.
Hopefully as you're hearing these, maybe you're resonating with these, that you realize, oh my God, we're doing that too. Or oh my God, that's happening around me, I've seen that, these are actions that I'm familiar with that I can identify with.
All right, we were talking about treating this like this is normal, like this is really supposed to be normal. And then also, you know, allowing our lawmakers in Washington to give this new regime more respect than the past regime. Because what we've seen over the past 8 years has been disgusting. And we need to improve the humans.
We talked about checking out and sort of disengaging. We talked about a lot of echoes from what's been said. Sort of acknowledging our privileged bubbles that we live in, that aren't intersecting with other types of representation and communication happening in that echo chamber that's sort of speaking to, those echoes.
Sorry. These are going to be repeated, but it's important for if there's multiples to hear them again. But we also talk about language and not letting humorizing letting familiarity be allowed for disrespectful language. And we also talked about the taking of money when the source of the money does not align with your values.
We talk about taking action to work outside of our bubble, even when it's we're all fighting to survive, but to make an effort to advocate and organize with other local organizations, and to be public, even in our own materials, about ways in which we may be contributing to gentrification, or practices that we may find ourselves in that we can't necessarily get out of, but to be public about that in our programming and materials.
He also spoke about acknowledging who might be funding our work and who our partners might be in that funding.
Are you? No. Okay. Is that everybody? Okay, great. Just by nodding, were there things that resonated that you found there were behaviors and actions that you may be a part of or see or be familiar with that's contributing to some of those undesirable results? Yes? Okay.
And it's good to be in a room and where you hear a lot of honest talk, and it kind of resituates you within your own struggle. So this next step, the third step, is the hardest. And I want to point that I'm going to ask you to, of course, do the thing you've been doing. What is the first step that you might take when addressing this problem? But I want you, we can write dissertations on it. But I want you to just think of the tiniest step, the first tiniest step possible. So I talked to you about the ways in which I know that the security folks in the building that I work in follow, especially young folks, non-white folks, people who look less wealthy, they followed them around the building. So the first, and I name that here today, there's so many difficult things I can name about where I work, but the first thing that I'm gonna do when I go back this week is we have to have a meeting, I have to have a meeting with the artistic director, and we have to begin to talk through how that behavior directly nullifies his mission and vision for the organization. So that's just a meeting. That's the first step I'm gonna take. I can't change it all by myself, but I can make that meeting happen. So don't be overwhelmed, just think of the first step, something that you could maybe initiate in the next 1 to 2 weeks.
And to, and even more specifically, to stop the unproductive behaviors that you just identified. Right? You're not gonna solve gentrification, you're not gonna solve the challenges of Trump's America. What is the thing that you can do to stop the behaviors? So in my example, it might be, I can have a meeting with my governance committee of my board to address term limits, to make it easier to facilitate more rapid change within the board, right? To change the makeup on one little thing. We can have a conversation about term limits. Doesn't mean I gotta fire the whole board and start from scratch. One little action to take to try to address an issue or a behavior that you identified.
And we're gonna repeat the 1, 2, 4 all pattern. So you have a minute to think on your own. Go ahead, thanks. And then you're going to share with a partner. And as you hear amazing things, write those good ideas down. You have a couple of minutes to share with a partner.
Thank you. I say that area is important. Can you describe an area?
This is my favorite part of the whole thing. Is getting to do this. It's my new favorite job. One of the things that came up in our group was the aspect of boards being in favor of programs that make money and establishments with only very blue chip organizations like blue chip museums or performing arts centers that are really established. And one of the first things that I will do is address this problem or this situation with my board and have an open discussion about what the real focus and mission is of Living Arts.
Speak up, even in the face of one's own fear. Join others who are organizing. Keep resisting and sharing information and communicating with our constituency.
Ours are volunteer, join the movement, be physically present. We have conservative family members and have conversations, ask them to read articles that might humanize perspectives, show them different human experiences than they're seeing. And finally, Michelle Obama 2020.
Make diverse programming not just a personal practice, but part of the organization's mission. Don't wait for the audience to come to us. We want to diversify our audience. To them, partner with other communities and see what they want to see and ask what they want.
My task is that our board is not diverse enough, so I am making it my task now personally to seek out diversity for our board members.
We're going to mobilize ourselves by having meetings like this in our homes, examining our banking practices, identifying social justice activist organizations to donate to on a monthly sustaining basis, and we have a couple of book recommendations for you.
Formulate a short statement against the practice of oppression that we add to our introductions, particularly whenever we educate or we're in a workshop situation. Have our friends call us out anytime we say anything or have a practice that we should be not doing. Downtown project for elders who've been displaced with condo owners, write letters, and greet our new neighbors as they move into our gentrified neighborhoods. Add our vision to and ask the people that we're partnering with what their vision is.
To make it a practice to research funding sources and not allow monetary need to be an excuse.
school, local public school, and find out how we can help the dozens of children that have been displaced from their homes in our community in the past year. We want to commit to sitting down and having a conversation with somebody that has a vastly different worldview than ourselves, and perhaps prepare for that by committing to read at least one long form of journalism article a week. And for me personally, next week I'm about to spend a week writing on this piece that I did my art burst on, which is looking at my own biography through the history of Oklahoma. But I'm going to switch that, so I'm looking really at the history of Oklahoma using my own biography just as the doorway.
We talked about speaking up and not giving ourselves a pass when we see something or say something, and organizing anti-racist trainings in our offices and workplaces.
Thank you. We want to acknowledge that this kind of process of, it's called destructive creativity in some ways, is really difficult when you have a group of folks from a lot of different backgrounds. And it's our experience, if you'll sit within your own organization, so people who have similar context, it begins to really surface some interesting conversations. So one of the things that we also wanted to model for this group was not only, oh, here's our thinking together, and here's where you're going to hear echoes across multiple organizations, but also that this is a technique that you can take back and pretty quickly do it with your own colleagues. If you have questions about any of the facilitations that you've seen this week, Ron and Brad, their contact information is pretty available on the Fusebox website. My contact information is pretty easy as well. It's simply Martinez, which is my last name, at Guthrie Theater, erontheater.org. Thank you for being so game, for having these conversations, for putting up with being time, for exchanging cards, for being really honest and in kinds of difficult ways. I'm going to rush out of here right now because I need to get on a plane in a little less than an hour. So we're going to head out. Again, thank you so much. Have a beautiful
evening. Okay. I want to thank Carra and Brad for listening all weekend, coming up with a great idea, working with you guys. Carra, obviously, you can go all the way in from Minneapolis, and there she goes. Thank you so much. Before I give you some announcements, logistics, I would like Caitlin Strokosh to say something. She would like to say something.
I'd like to say something. Hi. So remember when we started on Thursday morning, it was a really messy, difficult conversation, and it felt totally unwieldy, and it was kind of dissatisfying? You remember that? So where we got to today was kind of what I was hoping was going to unfold over a few days, so I think some of that is just due to your generosity and openness to continue having these conversations over a few days. Obviously, also Kara's really incredible facilitation for getting us here. And again, I want to just reiterate, this is the beginning of a conversation. We're on a journey together. And I can't think of a better group of people to be on this journey with. So thank you for your openness, despite, you know, the sort of messy, sloppy, ways that we're all sort of figuring out how to engage with each other around these topics, as we have in the last few days. I want to just give a huge thank you to all the folks here, locally, UT Austin, Fusebox, and Women and Their Work in particular, and all of the local artists and volunteers who gave so much of their time, both this week and in the months and the year in preparation for this. So local Austin folks, raise your hand. Organization, and I hope that we continue to go hand in hand together with both of those things in good measure. And for the new partners for joining us, it's really just a tremendous honor to have all of you here. the board of NPM Band really stepped up this week in particular to support me and the staff in this transition time for us, and they made sure that every single board member had jobs and roles throughout this week, that they were dispersed throughout idea forums and facilitation and all kinds of other things. So thank you all board members for being such incredible partners with us this week. And last but not least, to the amazing NPM Band staff, you guys. Mimi's got a couple of final announcements for us. Take it away.